story tells a lot about the Yankees in this series. 1-for-10 with runners on base.
That was the home run he hit in Milwaukee, Art.
That's right. When he had a brief flash in memory as Mr. October. Now he seeks another.
While the A's swept away the West, the Yankees look to do the same in the East against a team making its franchise postseason debut, the Brewers.
We thought we had a pretty good chance in 81 to beat them, and they came to Milwaukee and they beat us the first two games, and it looked pretty bad for us.
So we have a 2-0 lead coming back to Yankee Stadium, and all we have to do is win one ball game. We're feeling pretty good about ourselves.
But in the eighth inning of Game 3, with the score tied at 3, Paul Molitor changed the series with one swing of the bat.
Well hit to left. Molitor homers to left at about 380 feet, and the Brewers are back on top 4-3.
We had our suitcases packed, ready to go, and we had to go back to the hotel, and we won the game.
And the next day, Fingers was called in to protect a 2-1 lead in the ninth inning of Game 4.
Two outs, the tying runners at third, knocks down to Fingers and Cerrone.
The guy threw him four straight fastballs. He was right on him, and he fouled him back.
Cerrone got a piece of it, fouled it back, and stays alive.
Got to the next pitch, and Ted Simmons stuck down slider. And I said, okay, let's try a slider.
The Brewers had drawn the series even. One game would decide who was moving on, which certainly didn't please the Yankees' boss afterwards in the clubhouse.
I had struck out to end the game. Next thing you know, he's ranting and raving, and I thought he was talking about me, and I confronted him.
Which was a shocking event in itself, because whoever talked back to the boss.
Thank goodness Bobby Mercer stepped in the middle of us and got in between us. And then George had what I called the General Patton speech. He said that the great Yankees would turn over in their graves if we lost the next day.
We're getting set for game number 5 between the Milwaukee Brewers and the New York Yankees.
We felt as though we had the momentum after beating the Yankees twice in a row in their ballpark, and we knew we had our hands full with Guidry.
I've seen Gator in pressure situations before. Anytime you're in a game 5, he's the guy you want with the ball in his hand. So we felt very confident.
Right-hander Pete Vukovic caught off illness to pitch a strong 5 innings for a Milwaukee win in Game 4. Lefty Bob McClure, a second gutty performance in the series for Milwaukee as he strikes out Reggie Jackson in the 8th inning. Raleigh Fingers, third appearance in 4 games, the save as the Brewers win 2-1 to even the series, and tonight, the Eastern. There is virtually no way you could have a more mild, more pleasant, prettier evening than you've got in New York City tonight for Game 5 in the American League Eastern Division playoff series between the Yankees and the Brewers. When the New York Yankees went into Milwaukee to win the first two games of this American League East series, nobody gave Milwaukee much of a chance when they came back to Yankee Stadium to play the remaining games of this series. But Milwaukee's character has surfaced. They won 5-3 and 2-1 to even the series. And tonight, one game for the Eastern Division title. The Brewers will have to go without their young second baseman, Jim Gantner. His leg is banged up from a collision of last night at second base with Bobby Brown of the Yankees. There's been much ado here in New York today about George Steinbrenner's lecture in the Yankee clubhouse last night. Howard Cosell will comment on that. The Milwaukee relief corps is tired. The Yankees' big relief man, Goose Gossage, is rested. Don Drysdale will have a comment about the pitching. As we get ready tonight for the one-game decision for the American League East Championship.
Almost as always, turmoil surrounds the Yankees. Yankee owner George Steinbrenner watched the ending of the game yesterday in the Yankee clubhouse. The players trooped in. Acid comments between George Steinbrenner and Rick Cerrone, openly admitted by both. We'll have the full story there during the course of the contest from both principals, Steinbrenner and Cerrone. In the meantime, what about the effect of the turmoil on the Yankees themselves? May, if anything, help, judging from the past history of a group of great professionals, and they're accustomed to the antics of their owner, and they know there's a lot of truth to what he has said. The key tonight, the pitching on that subject, who better than Don Drysdale to tell you about it?
Thank you very much, Howard. Well, tonight, pitching definitely is going to be a key. The two starters tonight, Moose Haas for the Milwaukee Brewers. He lasted 3 1/3 innings in game number one at County Stadium, Milwaukee. He took the loss. Ron Guidry for the New York Yankees went 4 1/3 without a decision, and they are well rested. They are ready to go, much more so than anybody else on either staff. We talked at the start of this series about the middlemen for the Brewers. They have done an outstanding job. You couldn't ask for a better job. Now you go to the two short men. Raleigh Fingers is dog tired. He has been in 3 of the 4 ball games. On the other hand, Goose Gossage was rested yesterday. He is ready to go. If it gets down to that, it can be very interesting. Of course, there's no tomorrow. We've heard that before. We'll be right back. Game 5 in just a moment. Back here at Yankee Stadium now, the crowd coming to its feet for the singing of the national anthem. Miss Cheryl Howard, the lovely daughter of one of the great Yankees of all time, stepping to the microphone, Elston Howard's daughter, Cheryl.
Our national anthem will be sung tonight by the lovely daughter of the late great Yankee, Elston Howard. Ladies and gentlemen, here is Cheryl Howard.
So proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. Oh, the were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still.
Cheryl Howard, daughter of the late Elston Howard.
All right, let's get ready for the starting lineup of the Milwaukee Brewers. Paul Molitor, the catalyst, leading off. Robin Yount, the shortstop, batting second. Cecil Cooper, the great hitter, batting third. Ted Simmons, the slugger, batting fourth. Gorman Thomas, the biggest power man of all, designated hitter. Ben Ogilvie, the game-winning hit yesterday, sixth. Sal Bando, hitting .333, seventh. Charlie Moore back in right field. And then the change that has already been spoken of by Keith, Ed Romero for Jim Gant.
And here's Keith. The defense tonight for the Yankees features Bob Watson at first base. Over at second base, Willie Randolph. Willie's been shuffled around in a batting order tonight. We'll check that for you at the bottom of the inning. The shortstop is Larry Milburn, who has been a most welcome surprise for them. Greg Nettles, who's doing nothing with a bat, but carrying a great glove at third. In the outfield, Dave Winfield. who continues to be one of the best. Throws on you, as we said. Jerry Mumphrey in center field. A lot of speed to control that big area. And the man who has made three outstanding plays in right field since the series came back here, Reggie Jackson. Back of the plate, Rick Cerrone. I don't know whether to call him beleaguered or not. There have been times when it seemed he might have been. And on the mound, Ron Guidry, who was 11-5 on the year and who pitched 4 1/3 innings in the opening game at Milwaukee, did not figure in the decision in that ball game. So here is a youngster whose bat was quiet the first two games, but it's come alive here at Yankee Stadium. And I should say to you that never in the history of any kind of playoffs in organized baseball at the major league level has anyone visiting team won all of its games on the road for the decision. There's the final from Los Angeles. As you see, the Dodgers beat Houston 4-0. And it'll be Los Angeles and Montreal for the National League Championship. A one ball, one strike count. Guidry is low inside to make it 2-1.
It's going to be interesting to watch the selection of pitches that Ron Guidry uses tonight over in Milwaukee. It felt as though that he went to his breaking stuff too much. He did not go to the fastball.
2-2.
Cerrone said specifically that Guidry overused the slider.
The stadium is not filled tonight, but 25 or 35, however thousand it is here, and I don't know what is going to come up. They cheered on that one as he had Molitor tied in a knot.
Well, that was that good hard slider right there, Keith, and when he is right, he's got that slider with a good angle breaking down and in to the right-hand hitters, and he can be awfully tough.
Robin Yount, 3-for-14, with a single run batted in the series so far. He starts out hot, doesn't he? 92, 93, 94. That's hit foul to the right side, out of play. Al Clark behind the plate tonight. Mike Riley at first, Dale Ford at second, Larry McCoy at third. The umpires down the line, Ken Kaiser in left, and Dave Phillips in right.
In the Yankee turbulence, Guidry will be a free agent, tries to stay neutral.
That goes sailing out toward the shortstop. Greg Nettles fields the ball at third, and they just get Robin Yount. It's a little disconcerting to have a piece of lumber whirling at you while you're trying to field a ball.
Well, Robin got the ball. He got it. There's the slider. Got it out on the end of the bat. He's left with nothing but a handle. And really did not get a good start out of the box, and that play at first base was awfully close. He just about beat it. As a matter of fact, first base coach Ron Aston, he took maybe a step and a half towards Mike Riley, the first base umpire, and said, well, forget it.
The pitch is high to Cecil Cooper, who was saying before the ball game, bewildered almost, that he tightens up when he comes into this ballpark. He is not comfortable here.
There might be a few guys that have joined him tonight on both sides.
What a surprise.
Fouled away. A lot of marbles and chalk on the table in this one. The right to go on and play the Oakland A's for the American League Championship.
And roar in the crowd. They want the strikeout with two strikes.
Coop pops it up down the third baseline. It's going to be a play, I think, for Nettles. Oh, he fell in the photographer's box. And you all right? Come on there, Greg.
That's third base umpire Dale Ford.
Banged up. He's banged up.
That is a box that is put there, an auxiliary box put there strictly for the playoffs or World Series. It does not have a high railing whatsoever. You could see that once he got over, and the ground actually slopes, Keith, down towards the wall for the drainage purposes. So when he started,
he went in there head first. It is not that wide, and it looks like if there is injury to him, it's in the head area.
Looks like the jaw and the ear.
Sloping toward inserts that auxiliary box, so your momentum is going to be carrying you that way anyway. And then it hits him in a bad spot. It's way down, just about thigh high. And here he goes. Watch his jaw. Bam.
Oh, concrete.
That is the concrete part. Like a wallop. Now that'll make you check your fillings, I'll tell you that. But he took a really hard spill. That's tough. This goes right down on it. His arm was fully extended, so he couldn't catch himself and protect himself, and the left side of his face came right down on that concrete. What might have helped him, Keith, was just under the left arm. That hit a little bit. That might have really saved him. Gonna stay. Just threw away a tooth. You can eat a few meals through a straw doing that.
You bet. He's a tough guy.
He'll stay as Coop slices the ball out to left, and those long legs of infield come pounding in to make the catch. And so the Brewers are going in order in the top of the first with the Yankees coming up.
Changing the Yankee lineup tonight, Jerry Mumphrey leading off, Larry Milburn batting second, Dave Winfield batting third, Reggie Jackson still in the cleanup spot, then Oscar Gamble at DH, then Greg Nettles, the man who just got hurt, then Bob Watson, after him Rick Cerrone, and not the catalyst tonight, not batting ninth, Willie Randolph, because he is batting ninth.
Defensively for Milwaukee, it's Cecil Cooper remaining at first base. It is a second base where the new change is tonight. With Gantner down, Ed Romero, a utility man, steps in. Shortstop is Ed's normal position, but he is a good defensive player. Robin Yount remains at shortstop for the Brewers. And over at third, steady Sal Bando. Out in the outfield, it's Ben Ogilvie, whose bat is beginning to wake up. In center field, Paul Molitor, who had started the series in right, went to center when Gorman Thomas hurt his hand. And Charlie Moore, a catcher by trade, is back in right field again tonight. Behind the plate, Ted Simmons, whose bat has been ringing of late. And on the mound will be Moose Haas, who started for Milwaukee in the opening game back last Wednesday. Was rattled around some, including a two-run home run by Oscar Gamble and a double in the fourth inning.
Haas has all your basic pitches, a fastball, curveball, slider. He's come up with a little split-finger fastball. He's had that for a while and really has not put it to use. He used it the last couple of games against the Tigers. He had a little problem trying to work the deception part out. Alex Gramas, the third base coach, could pick it up and actually relay with a whistle onto the hitter, so he's had to work on his act a little bit.
Mumphrey, who has good speed in the leadoff spot against the right-hander, takes a strike. Larry Milburn in the number two spot may be the best bunter on the New York ball club. That could be a factor. The ball is fouled away back of the plate. Hold to Cooper, who'll flip it to Haas. One out. The Los Angeles Rams coming from behind to beat Atlanta today, 37-35.
And what a day for Leroy Urban. We saw him against the Bears run a kickback for a touchdown. Another decent day for Richard Todd. Jets hung on to beat the Patriots. And three times in a row, the Super Bowl champions have been shut out. Kansas City 27-0.
It's a soft liner looping out into left center. Coming across for it is Molitor. The ball goes off of his glove. And Larry Milburn motors into second base.
Molitor, not an outfielder by profession. And that time it showed.
I think Ben Ogilvie coming across may have bothered him as well.
There's exactly the case. They just never got together. Now, usually it's the center fielder who is the captain out there. He will take charge and usually make all the catches that he can get to. That ball was slicing away from Molitor, slicing into Ogilvie. It might have been a better catch for Ogilvie, or an easier catch.
Liberal scoring. They give him a double.
Eagles, the only unbeaten,
tied team in the NFL. Houston crushing Seattle. Earl Campbell's second great day in a row. 182 yards a week ago. Good day for Kenny Stabler. Tampa Bay over Green Bay and Doug Williams red hot. Washington winning its first of the year. Chicago in a hapless state.
Milburn at second. The pitch to Dave Winfield. Ball one.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting as you look at Larry Milburn at second base for both clubs. And you look at these clubs throughout the course of the year, they've got a lot of power going down each lineup. But the bats have been relatively quiet through this whole series, and the scores indicate that.
Took a second look at umpire Al Clark. He felt the ball was low, but it only dropped after it had gone over the plate knee-high or better.
Winfield, with 7 hits and 16 trips, has not batted in a run. Profited from the simple fact he's a left-hander. They're able to get Winfield at first as Milburn goes to third, two out.
Boy, there's a great play by Cecil Cooper. And you're an infielder, you've got to be thinking, if you can get to the ball, you've got to knock it down to save the run. And that's what Coop does. The ball almost rolls away from him. If it rolls any further, they're going to have trouble getting that big guy lumbering down the line right behind Haas. A good play by Cooper, a good play by Haas. He stops very quickly because he knows that Milburn's at third with excellent speed.
Right-handed first baseman doesn't make that play.
It's tough.
Jackson up now, Reggie, with 2 runs batted in. 3 for 16 and a home run. That's hit a mile high and 4 miles long. To the track, and Charlie Moore. The crowd was up screaming, and the ball got to the apex of its flight, and then it just hung there, nestled softly in Charlie's glove. No score. For a fraction of a second, it appeared that shot by Reggie might go, but it kept going up instead of out.
He had everything working for him. You see, Reggie's thinking it might be the home run. It might be. He said, well, maybe I better run a little bit. Now he sees Charlie Moore about this time pounding a glove and holding both hands up. And that's the kind where you say all you do is make a right turn. 0-for-1.
And we go to the top of the second inning for the Milwaukee Brewers. It'll be Ted Simmons, Gorman Thomas, and Ben Ogilvie. Him with a strike. Simmons in the series 4-for-15 with a home run and 4 runs batted in. And that's a fly ball to right center. Jackson drifting over. Makes the catch.
Number 20.
Now it's Gorman Thomas. And Gorman Thomas has been at bat 7 times with 10 base runners aboard. He has advanced 1. That came when he walked. As you see the dimensions of Yankee Stadium, Thomas, the DH, because of the sore throwing hand, has no runs batted in the series. Has trouble with the outside pitch. Cannot control the bat. He loses control with his top hand at pitches outside on the outer portion of the strike zone. Guidry comes to his wheelhouse with that one, brought it right into him, but just blew it by him at 93 miles an hour.
Well, it's obvious that his hand is bothering him, Keith, and as you say, that pitch on the outside part of the plate, he just can't approach it. He struck out 7 times in the series.
1-1.
He will strike out, but I don't think you'll see him strike out on a lot of pitches that he struck out in this series.
Guidry said this is just another game. You don't believe that, do you?
Not the way he came out pumping.
You don't believe he meant it for a minute, do you?
Well, it depends on how he defines just another game.
Bob clapping for the strikeout at 1-2. Nope. It's hit to left field. Winfield.
Goodbye.
Oh, a it's gone. Thomas is on the scoreboard. Gorman hits a home run out of here at 380 feet.
Well, they didn't get the fastball out far enough that time. They just got it up over the plate. And Thomas, who on the year hit 21. And he's capable of that at any time. And Winfield knew all the way. Now watch the location of the fastball. Right there, and he's ready. He stayed on that ball well.
And the Brewers break on top, 1-0 in the top of the second inning. One out, and here's Ben Ogilvie. You see Winfield go to the wall. Remember the other night when he went over the wall?
No point leaping for that one.
Nope. 10 rows back. Ball one to Ogilvie. Benji starting to come around now. He got his first base hit. It was a big double, and it knocked in a run. The first time Ben Ogilvie faced Ron Guidry, he hit a home run into the upper deck here at Yankee Stadium. Gorman Thomas back in the dugout after putting the Brewers on top 1-0, and the pitch is in to make it 3-1. The pitch, hard slider.
That's a good
number
pitch.
Six,
that is a nasty Carol pitch Randall. Right there, Keith.
Yep. But the pitch to Thomas was not nasty, and that's what matters. In the meantime, the game's in the pattern of game number one.
Mendel, line shot to Nettle, side retired. But the Brewers take the lead in the top of the second inning. 1-0 over the New York Yankees as a result of Gorman Thomas' home run. See Greg Nettles fielding that hot shot off the bat of Bando. 1-0, Milwaukee. Ron Guidry will watch from the dugout now. Trailing 1-0 as Oscar Gamble, Greg Nettles, and Bob Watson come to the plate for the Yankees. Gamble against Haas, a two-run home run. Oscar 4-for-6, and 2 runs batted in the series. Oscar hits it on the ground. Ed Romero's first opportunity, almost bobbled it.
Well, that's what Romero was hoping for, Keith. He hasn't started, as you mentioned earlier, why Jimmy Gander out of the lineup with that bad leg, but that's what an infielder wants to have happen. Give me a ball hit at me.
We've got a good one for you tomorrow night. Miami against Buffalo. The Bills wanting to get at Miami to get closer to first place in the AFC East. They're at 3-2. Miami at 4-0-1. And they're still smarting over the way the Jets played in overtime. The Bills are against Miami in their recent 28-28 tie.
Greg Nettles looks at a slider for a strike. Greg has walked 3 times in 17 at-bats. He has no hits. Foul ball.
Talking with, look at this score right here, Howard.
So illustrative is the graphic on Tony Dorsett. If ever a score shows you that coaching is everything in the NFL, that score does. Bill Walsh taking over. What a job he's done. And Dan Reeves pulling a miracle at Denver. Craig Morton, alive and young.
High fly ball to center field for Paul Molitor. Fighting it a little bit, but he makes the catch for the second out.
There's a little bit of a breeze out there. And at times, I've just been watching the flags. They will hang fairly limp. At times, they'll pick up a little bit. And, of course, that's going to affect it to the right side.
Hey, do you believe this one? Of course, there's disarray in that San Diego team. They're still in turmoil over the trade of John Jefferson, the departure of Fred Dean. But give Bud Grant and Tommy Kramer credit.
Johnson. You don't think Fred Dean won't help that San Francisco defense?
Mm-hmm. Probably did today.
Just off the outside corner.
And the Giants came to life. Big day for Phil Sims. Remember, St. Louis beat Dallas a week ago. Having lost two in a row, the Cowboys, suddenly a suspect football team. Mrs. Watson. You don't think those wives think it's just another game? Do you, Keith?
No, sir. That's foul to the right side. You've got a count of 2-2 with two out. Milwaukee leading by a score of 1-0. Yankees batting bottom of the second. To the shortstop, Robin Yount. Whoa. Nice stretch by Coop. After two at Yankee Stadium, Brewers one, Yankees nothing. Charlie Moore now for the Milwaukee Brewers in the top of the third inning. Ed Romero will follow, and then Paul Molitor for the second time around.
Keith, that was really a big inning for Moose Haas to come back and turn the Yankees away, because that's like that for every pitcher. When your club gives you a lead, if you can turn that opposing club away the next time you go out there and give your club a chance to come back and increase your lead.
Leonard Hearns, October 17 on ABC's Wide World of Sports. The World Series begins October 20. Marathon, October 25. Some of the highlight events during ABC Sports Oktoberfest.
Leonard Hearns, by the way, Keith, will be in the studio with me. As for the first time on home television, you see that very memorable event.
Charlie Moore, he's a catcher by trade, but he still has pretty good speed. And Nettles back at third. Moore will dump it on you. Molitor will bunt. Yount will bunt. You've got a lot of people in that Milwaukee lineup that will bunt.
Hits it in the air to left for Winfield. Short left. Dave comes loping in. One down.
Number 11.
Now Ed Romero.
Ed Romero.
Playing instead of Jim Gentner in tonight's ball game, making his first appearance in the Eastern Division playoffs. They will examine Gentner tomorrow in Milwaukee to determine the degree of Jimmy's injury. Gorman Thomas, towel wrapped around him. Gorman hit the home run in the second inning to give Milwaukee the 1-0 lead. Romero hits it in the air to left center. And the center fielder can't get there. It's in no man's land.
Well, Milburn went out, and he was in the wrong direction. And it was Mumphrey who had to come the longest way of anybody to try and make the catch. There, a big swing. That'll fool an outfielder at times. It'll make him hold ground. He hit it on the end of the bat. And now Milburn going back. Well, you can see that ball's 10 feet the other side of him.
It went the wrong way and then lost it. So it drops. And Milwaukee now with one out. Romero at first and Molitor at the plate. Struck out swinging first time. Count on Molitor. Line score of the ball game. Pitch out again.
I believe that the Brewers have changed that hit and run sign. They have been successful three times in this series with Cerrone pitching out while the Milwaukee Brewers had the hit and run on. Yesterday, the key was Paul Molitor started, stopped, and got back to the bag when they scored their two runs.
As a result of the two pitch-outs, has gone to 3-1 on Molitor.
Now you could see something happen because they can't pitch out now.
Romero edges off. Guidry goes over there. Did they have a full house last night?
They were 52.
They were sold out, although they all didn't show up. I don't think that's true tonight.
Molitor walks. Romero goes to second. One out for Robin Young.
So Guidry continues to have trouble with Milwaukee. In his brilliant year in 78, his 13-game winning streak was snapped by these Milwaukee Brewers. He was knocked out in game number one of this series. He is struggling now in the third inning, having given up a home run to Gorman Thomas in the second. And the explosion in the clubhouse after yesterday's game by the owner has so far given no evidence of a Yankee resurgence.
Ball is hit high in the air, back behind the plate. Cerrone coming. And it's beyond his reach.
The Yankees appear listless, non-aggressive at the plate. Left a man on second. He got there. In the first inning, with only one out, as Molitor had difficulty with a Milburn fly to left center.
Punches it. Oh, through the hole. Rand knocks it down. Throws not in time. Randolph was breaking toward the bag at second, and it opened the door on that one.
I don't know what happened there. Willie Randolph took two strikes towards second base and then went back and just did knock it down, and he saves a run. But there shows you the speed of Young. Now Randolph, for some reason, had broken to the bag, gets it, gets up, but Young across the bag and across easily, and now the base is loaded with only one out. Cooper the hitter, and they will go out and check Willie Randolph.
Why would he go toward the back?
I have no idea, unless he just lost the ball for a moment, Keith. I have no idea whatsoever. Sometimes an infielder will lose a ball, and they start stirring around in the Yankee bullpen right now.
George Frazier, the right-hander, and Rudy May, the left-hander. And at the plate, it's Cecil Cooper, who has a chance, if he can get the ball to the outfield, to bring home another run for the Milwaukee Brewers. Only one out, and the bases are loaded.
They're up at the corners, Keith. Nettles and Watson. They play for the double play up the middle.
And Guidry's pitch to Cooper is outside, ball one.
Even this early, it's obvious the Yankees face a crisis. They can't risk a blowout.
Cooper hits the ball high in the air to left field for Dave Winfield. Romero tags at third. Winfield's throw is cut off. They go to third. They don't get him there. Milburn covering. Nettles, the cutoff man. He whips it over, and the base runner goes slamming in on his tummy, and Molitor is safe.
And the Brewers play aggressive baseball. Molitor and Yamp back to back. So fast, the way they can catalyze a ball club. And here, Winfield with a good arm.
Well, he does the right thing. He hits the cutoff man, Nettles. Ducky has a little trouble getting that ball out of the glove, but Molitor, with excellent speed, he's going to third because Winfield is fairly deep, and he knows he can judge for himself, can I go or can I?
You're right that he had a little trouble getting the ball out of the glove, but that's reflective of the way the Yankees are playing.
Yount moved up to second base on the play at third. Milwaukee leading now 2-0. In the top of the third inning for Ted Simmons, he has a strike.
And all of his base hits, Keith, have come from the right side in this series. Yep.
And the pitch is low. Make it 3-1.
Guidry in a constant struggle. Not the Guidry he used to sing. There, Gorman Thomas on deck.
3-1 pitch to Simmons. 3-2.
At this moment, we have the exact pattern of the first game, Keith.
3-2. Coming to Ted. Line foul.
He didn't give in to him on the 3-1 pitch. He came with a hard slider, and he came right back with a hard slider, 3-2.
Him up on the right side, first baseman Bob Watson. Side retired. Milwaukee with single runs in the second and third innings, lead 2-0. That's a look at Yankee Stadium out of the Bronx from our helicopter camera. One of the big features this time of the year, of course, in this part of the country, is to get off up into Connecticut and New Hampshire and Vermont and Maine and Massachusetts and wherever to look at the foliage. And Times today had a big route map for people so they could go look at it. It's really pretty this time of the year. All right, Moose Haas delivers, and it's shot up the middle by Rick Cerrone for a base hit.
Situation about Cerrone is he was having an exceptional series until the base running mishap yesterday that occasioned the verbal altercation between him and owner George Steinbrenner. But he's been hitting the ball solidly throughout the series, made two extraordinary plays behind the plate on pop fouls, and now he responds with a base hit to open the bottom of the third.
Willie Randolph batting ninth in the order tonight, and it's the first time this year that Willie Randolph has not led off for the New York Yankees. First time when he has been in the lineup. Well, this could be just a move right here, and of course I'm sure it is, just to relax him just a little bit. He's got three hits and 17 at-bats with an RBI. Get him down there where maybe he can relax a little bit. Doesn't put all the pressure on him. One ball, one strike.
His failure to hit in the number one slot is why Dave Winfield has no runs batted in for the series. And that graphic tells it, too. Because Winfield's had a hot series.
That's punched down the right side and foul ball. Charlie Moore's in there in a hurry to get it, but it's outside the lines. The funny thing about all of this, the Oakland A's have left California, and we understand they're sitting in Milwaukee right now waiting to the outcome of this game. Do they stay, or do they get back on their charter and come to New York? They're to be congratulated. Boy, they had a great year. The pitch is low, and it's 2-2.
So did Billy Martin in all respects.
Yes, sir.
Become one of the leading commercial actors on television. He didn't punch no doggy.
It's the first time in years they've had to grease the stern turnstiles at Oakland Stadium, too. Over a million. 2-2. Struck him out. What's he calling?
He's going to say, did it hit the ground or not? Mike Riley is now going to say he's asking for help. And Riley says, yes, I think it hit the ground. Riley didn't know. Here comes the third base umpire coming in. And now Bob Rogers is going out. He wants to talk to Riley. Ted Simmons, he's a little bit hot. Al Clark, the home plate umpire, did not see if Simmons caught the ball or if he got it on the hop. There's a crew chief, Dave Phillips. He's at third base tonight. And now Rogers wants to talk to Riley.
I think what Buck is saying is that Riley was well back to first base. He doesn't believe that Mike could have seen it.
He wants to know, did you see it hit the dirt first or not?
Well, to give you further backdrop to that, we told you last night. Now watch again.
Take another look at it. But Al Clark is right in asking for help. And he's right.
He's right.
He's dead right. Ball did go in the dirt. And the count 2-2 as Randolph stays alive. Pops him up on the right side. Romero calls for it. And Ed makes the catch for the first out. Cerrone stays at first base.
Well, after the game a couple of days ago, I went with George Steinbrenner and Bowie Kuhn. We viewed tapes of the two disputed calls by umpires on that occasion, Dale Ford and Mike Riley. And tonight, Lee McPhail was up with George Steinbrenner viewing the same tapes. And here we had another umpire situation. This time, the umpires were right.
Well, that's a good thing about the umpires right here. What they're doing is they're helping one another, and that's what you have to have. They do that more so now than at any time. If they're not sure, Al Clark's a very fine umpire. He was not sure of that whatsoever, and bang, he went right away to Riley at first base, which he should have done. Bouncer up the middle for Robin Young. Steps on the back, whips on the first, and that'll do it. So, we played three at Yankee Stadium in New York, and the Brewers lead the Yankees 2-0.
I can tell a real cowboy from the drugstore kind, clean across Texas. The way he wears his hat will tell you, and the beer that you drink's a surefire giveaway, too. A lot of us drink light beer from Miller. We love the taste, but we surely appreciate that it's got a third less calories than the regular kind. You see, you don't want to be filled up when you're out there punching doggies. Ain't that right, cowboy?
I didn't punch that doggie.
Light beer from Miller. Everything you always wanted in a beer, and less.
Ron Guidry back to the mound, down 2-0. He'll be pitching to Gorman Thomas, who nailed him for a home run. Ben Ogilvy, who struck out swinging, and Sal Bando, who had a hot shot to Nettle to third. Dave Righetti in the bullpen.
Well, they will go with staff, as Milwaukee will go with staff, as they said in this situation. You don't win tonight. You sit home and tune in the TV set the next day or so. Now, they've got Righetti. He's had a couple of days rest, and he only went six innings over in County Stadium.
He's only 22 years old, too. He's resilient. That was at third. Throws him out. Ogilvy comes up now, having struck out against Guidry his first time tonight. Can't reach it, drops for a base hit. Now Ben with two hits in the series.
I don't know about that. I'd like to see that again. That ball hung a little bit. That was... I wonder if Jerry starts right away. Ogilvy, the big swing.
No, he didn't.
Now he just lays back.
Sal Bando.
Series.
Strike one.
Boy, there were so many key plays in that game yesterday. I mean, things that you wouldn't see in the box score today.
That's foul back.
And one was him coming right in a bunt situation, Keith, with Larry Milburn. Of course, you were down in Texas during the football game. But he came in there in the first pitch. Milburn fouled it off. He came in there the second pitch and then backed off and made Milburn hit and hit into the force play at second base.
Two-strike count on Sal. Struck out.
Charlie Moore.
Pretty nasty pitch, too.
He can throw. He's capable. Definitely. Young man throwing in the bullpen is, too. Dave Righetti.
Charlie Moore, fly ball to left field, first time. There's a strike. High and tight, evens at two.
Moore is battling.
He is a battler. Little guy's a competitor. He's a good ball player. 2-2. Away 3-2. Brewers single runs in the top of the second, top of the third. They're at bat here in the top of the fourth. They have Ogilvy at first base and two out.
He has had to work very hard in every inning since the first.
He's tried to overthrow those last three sliders of his, the breaking pitches. Now Ogilvy will be going on the pitch.
Ben breaks. Moore hits it in the air to left for Winfield.
Dave makes the catch, and the Brewers are turned away after 3.5 innings of play. Milwaukee 2, New York nothing.
Buffalo may be talking proud, but undefeated Miami is out to prove it's only talk. The AFC East battle of the season when the Dolphins meet the Bills this week on ABC's Monday Night Football.
Now look at what happened this afternoon in the National League. The Dodgers beating Houston 4-0 to win that series 3-2. Montreal beating Philadelphia 3-0 to win that series 3-2. The Dodgers were down 0-2, went home to win 3 in a row. Montreal had won 2 in a row in Philadelphia and finally won the clincher today. And the pitch now to Larry Milburn by Ryan Edmund Haas is in there for a strike.
Boy, that Olympic Stadium will be hopping, won't it?
Up the middle it goes. Robin Yount can't get it. Haas and his follow-through have pulled himself completely out of position to make any kind of a play on that ground ball.
So the surprise of the year for the Yankees continues to be that Larry Milburn. But in the overview of this game, from the Yankee viewpoint, they have not been able to do anything to make things happen. Maybe they can now. Mike Caldwell, Buck Rogers told us before the game, he would have Mike ready in the bullpen.
Well, you're going to have everybody ready down there, Howard, tonight. They'll go back and forth, right-handers, left-handers, right-handers, left-handers, depending on who's there, if they can get out of an inning to keep away from any big inning.
All right, Dave Winfield now with a man on base in front of him and nobody out. Reggie Jackson on deck. It was the fourth inning in Milwaukee in which Haas got in trouble. Comes inside for ball one.
That's all. You can see where it's at. And Dave, his first approach is away a little bit. He likes that ball out there where he can extend his arm. He's a big target at the plate, but he's got all tools to protect himself with, I'll tell you that.
Punches the ball to the right side for Charlie Moore. Starts in, backs up, makes the catch. And everybody in Milwaukee Blue takes a deep breath of relief. One out for Reggie.
Well, that story tells a lot about the Yankees in this series. 1-for-10 with runners on base.
That was the home run he hit in Milwaukee, Art.
That's right. When he had a brief flash in memory as Mr. October. Now he seeks another.
He just sounded.
That's gone.
stricken by the swing of Reggie Jackson's bat as he rifles it over the upper deck facade. The ball game is tied at two.
He got a high curveball, and I'll tell you one thing, Reggie got all of it.
Look at that. See, that time with that smile, he knew.
Well, if he doesn't know it by then, why, he's never hit one before. He knows that ball is gone.
That's Mr. October. I talked to Reggie before the game. Time may permit you to see and hear that interview when he talked about last night's set to in the Yankee clubhouse and the impact it might have on the team.
Oscar Gamble up, ball one. Now, that's one thing about left-hand hitters in Yankee Stadium. You've got to be so careful with it. That's a short fortune right.
But that's the fuse they had to have lit. Maybe it will, maybe it won't.
Two balls and no strikes. Mike Caldwell throwing in the Milwaukee bullpen. Ed Simmons to the mound.
Now there's another look at it. You can see everything together. Bam, there's a quick bat. Of course, it was a high off-speed curveball.
Look at that. Just standing there watching. Look at the people in the background.
Oscar
on
knew it.
Their feet.
Well, Moose Haas bit by a two-run home run by this man, Oscar Gamble, in the first game at Milwaukee, and now it's Reggie Jackson that strikes one against him. And Gamble takes that pitch on the inside corner for a strike. Two and one.
Interesting, isn't it, Keith, how the pattern of the first game repeats itself?
So.
Brewers with singleton runs in the second and third. The Yankees with a home run explosion in the fourth.
Fouled away. Off the umpire.
Oscar clearly not happy with himself over that swing.
Well, he got himself a high-breaking pitch, too, and fouled it back. You can just hear the sound of the ball, and you know it's gone. Caldwell throwing in the bullpen.
Especially you, pitching to Aaron.
That's right. I've heard that sound. I hear it. I still hear it in my sleep.
Ends him away. Three and two. Buck Rogers now starting to prowl around in the Milwaukee dugout.
This could be a very big man for Moose Haas right here.
Yep.
You can't go too far with a guy now.
He loses him, it may be over.
Hit deep to right.
That's gone. Forget it.
The Yankees take the lead. A two-run homer by Jackson. Solo homer by Gamble, and Mike Caldwell will come on for Milwaukee.
And they got the same pitch that Jackson hit, a high curve ball. Take another look at it. There it is, and there's no question about that one either.
Happens fast in this game, doesn't it? A listless, dead ball club, and Reggie Jackson lit the fuse. Gamble followed suit. We'll be right back.
Almost a full moon tonight. And the pitch to Reggie. That's gone. Tie score. Holy cow. Upper deck job for Reggie Jackson. And that quickly the ball game is tied up. Holy cow. There was no doubt about that one. Mr. October hit one 9 miles. All right, Reginald.
Here's your chance to get the official 1981 World Series program, a collector's item commemorating the 78th Fall Classic. Send check or money order for $4 to World Series Program, Post Office Box 250, Hicksville, New York, 11802. Please make checks payable to World Series Program. New York residents must add appropriate sales tax. That's World Series Program, Box 250, Hicksville, New York. Allow 8 weeks for delivery. The preceding message was furnished by Major League Baseball.
We have told you about last night's verbal altercation in the Yankee clubhouse. An angry George Steinbrenner leveling out the Yankees for their errors, mental errors, and the altercation with Cerrone. Here's my talk with George.
George, why don't you describe in your words what happened in the clubhouse right after the game last night?
Well, Howard, there was no barging into the clubhouse, no tirade. I was in the clubhouse watching the ninth inning with the pitchers, and when the game was over, the players all came in, and I told them to come in and sit down and be quiet. I had something I wanted to say to them. And right then, I was talking about shoddy base running and mental lapses. You know, I can tolerate striking out with men in scoring position, and I can tolerate a lot of things in baseball as long as I believe they're trying. But mental lapses, mental mistakes, and failure to execute the fundamentals of baseball, I can't tolerate. Not when players are getting paid what these players are getting paid. And I was telling him that. It happens as Rick walked in, and Rick was frustrated because he just struck out with a scoring run on third, and he had had a bad day on the bases. And I guess he thought I was zeroing in too much on him, and he made a remark, which was made in frustration, and I asked him what he'd said, and he replied again, and I said something back to him. But as I've told Rick today, that means nothing. It's like water off a duck's back to me. It's something said in frustration, and what I said back to him may have been an immediate anger, and therefore neither of them can be of any consequence in striving to what we're our goals, which are to play good baseball, good sound fundamental baseball, and to win a championship for New York Yankees. That's my fundamental goal, and I didn't attach any importance to what he said. I did tell my team.
Okay, and in that vein, you sent Rick a little note today in which you explained exactly what you've just stated here.
Well, you found out about that. I don't know how, but that's true. And because I want him to understand where I'm coming from and what is paramount to me, and the fact that he said something as he did to me doesn't mean that he's not going to be here next year. He doesn't need to have a sleepless night tonight or worry about something. The only thing that I demand from my players is that if they want to be the highest priced team in baseball and they want these big salaries, then they're not going to be allowed to make mental mistakes and have lapses on the base paths and be not do a sound fundamental job of baseball.
Telling it like it is. Thank you, George.
All right, Howard. Thank you.
Pre-game comments of Yankee owner George Steinbrenner. Greg Nettles has just shed the collar. He singles into right. And you're going to get some more activity out of the pen.
Got a right-hander up, and the
Bernard.
Cap is waving, and he's ready.
Bernard. All right, here's Bob Watson. And Mike Caldwell gets a strike on Bob. So the Yankees in this inning, Melbourne singled, Winfield hit a fly ball to right, Jackson hit a two-run home run, Gamble a solo home run, Nettles a single off Mike Caldwell, who relieved Haas. And that's up the middle. Caldwell can't get it. Yount dives. He can't get it. Nettles turns, goes to third. Runners on the corner with one out. Now that ball hit back up the middle. I believe that ball's got to be fielded
by the pitcher.
Yes, sir. It's got to be fielded by the pitcher. You take another look at it. Watson, first of all, doesn't hit the ball hard. He hits it off the end of the bat. A very weak swing. Caldwell just doesn't get down there. And he really turns his back on the ball. He thought, I believe, that the ball was hit harder than what it actually was.
He's gone, and we'll get Bernard in now. A right-hander against the right-handed hitting Cerrone as Buck Rogers, going to his pitching staff, trying to keep the Yankees away from a big inning. They've already scored three times and have taken the lead here in the bottom of the fourth by a score of 3-2. Time out. We'll be back.
I've had to write some tough things about some tough guys. But there's one guy I can't write anything bad about. His unique brand of baseball has made him a living legend. So have his commercials. They got me to try his favorite beer, light beer from Miller. Light's less filling, and it really tastes great. So I bought this light for that renowned, yet humble man, Art Thornberry.
Cheer up, Billy. One day you'll be famous just like me.
Light beer from Miller. Everything you always wanted in a beer, and less.
Dwight Bernard comes into the ballgame now. Second appearance in the playoff series. Pitched two-thirds of an inning in the opening game in Milwaukee. The Yankees, two home runs of the inning by Jackson and Gamble. A single by Milburn, and now a single by Nettles, and a single by Watson. There
There's your scoring summary with Thomas. Home run in the second inning for the first run of the game, 1-0 Milwaukee. Third inning, Romero single, Molitor walk, Yount single, Cooper sacrifice fly, Milwaukee 2-0. And the Yankees have come back here in the fourth. They take the lead 3-2. And with only one out, they have an opportunity to add more. Over at third base, you have Nettles. And at first base, you have Watson. Rogers going to his third pitcher in this ballgame, trying to keep the Yankees away from a big inning.
And you've got a left-hander throwing right behind him. That's exactly what I said before. You got to go to your staff, go to your bullpen. There's Bob McClure, who did a fine job yesterday.
The pitch to Rick Cerrone. Hit toward the hole. Yount gloves it. Goes back to second. Get one there, and the relay to first is not in time.
Well, do you realize?
Really sure he held that bag.
What a great play that was by Yount, and they come just a whisker from getting a double play. That ball hit to the hole, and look how far Robin Yount has to go. And all high hoppers, his momentum taken to the line, but a strong throw. He has a great arm. There's Romero. He gets the ball back, and Cerrone just does beat it.
Meantime, Nettles scores to make it 4-2 New York. And here's Willie Randolph. That's fine.
It's uncanny. It's exactly what happened in game number one. Four-run fourth inning. Shelling out Moose Haas.
But I'll tell you, Bernard was within a millisecond of getting out of that inning right there. 1-2 is hit to right for Charlie Moore. And Charlie makes the catch. But it is an inning of substance for the New York Yankees as they score four and take the lead after four innings of play, 4-2.
A sports update brought to you by Brute by Fabergé. Now, from ABC News in New York, Dick Schaff.
Good evening. It will be the Montreal Expos against the Los Angeles Dodgers for the National League Championship. Steve Rogers led the Expos to their victory with his bat, driving in the first two runs and with his pitching, shutting out the Phillies on a six-hitter. Jerry Royce led the Dodgers to their victory, shutting out Houston on a five-hitter. The championship series opens Tuesday in Los Angeles. Now this.
Give it your best shot.
Today's your Brute Day. It's your lucky Brute Day.
Make every day your Brute Day with Brute by Fabergé.
Today.
The National Football League, the most stunning result, surprising San Francisco crushing Dallas with Joe Montana passing for two of the 49ers' touchdowns. Philadelphia remained undefeated and untied, and Pittsburgh's revived Steelers won their fourth straight. More later on the ABC News Weekend Report.
Dave Righetti comes on for his second appearance in the playoff series. He was the winning pitcher in game number two, six innings, no earned runs. Gave four hits, struck out 10 people in six innings, and he walked two. And they're out now picking up Reggie's walking around money.
Well, they throw him quarters. It's a habit that's grown here. Reggie can't keep all the money. Turns it over to his favorite charities. But one day came in with, during the course of the game, over $81 in quarters. See, Reggie's saying, please don't throw any more down. Of course, it becomes a physical danger. But Drysdale's ready to run out there. I'll pick it up.
So am I. The book on Guidry, as you have a reminder of tomorrow night's football game between the Miami Dolphins and the Buffalo Bills from Buffalo. Have a nice trip, Howard. Stay warm.
It's not as far as Texas.
Guidry, four innings, two earned runs, four hits, struck out three, walked one. And it's not of particular significance, really, I don't think, to you, Don, that Righetti is in.
Well, they were talking about splitting prior to the game. They were talking about go as far as you can, and then we might come right back and bring in Rigetti. And that's what Bob Lemon has done right now. But Rigetti has had 2 days off, Keith, and he's a young man. As you look at Reggie Jackson, he only pitched 6 innings over there, so he should be ready to go. And I'll tell you one thing, they're going to see some heat.
Yeah, you're right.
1-1 now. Ed Romero leading off for Milwaukee, then the top of the order, Molitor and Yount. 1-2.
Though it's 93 miles an hour, Keith. Plain truth, Guidry was shaky. They know that Ron hasn't been all that effective against the Brewers. Rigetti ready, put him in.
And get to the eighth where you can get the Gossage. Check him out. That's 11 Brewers this young left-hander has fanned now. Just another good fastball with something on it, and he just throws it right by Romero. 94 miles an hour on that last one.
Gossage has rested. He did not work yesterday.
Nope, so he is ready to go. So what the Yankees, the way you got to play the Yankees, you got to play them in 7 innings. You got to try and stay away from Gossage.
That's the essential point we've made throughout the series.
Strike one on Molitor.
These teams play 6-inning games, Keith.
That's right.
Fingers and Gossett. Sure can't fault old Raleigh for what he's done in this series, though. He's been terrific for Milwaukee. 1-1. The middle, slow roller. Randolph throws him out. Two down. Brewers can't dance with him, though. They've got to come up swinging here in the top of the fifth.
They're dancing as fast as they can, to paraphrase the title of a book. New movie, by the way, starring Jill Clayburgh. Got some scenes at my house.
They pay you for it?
No, I'm not there.
What it was.
Some bullets.
Well, he's not monkeying around with any off-speed pitches. He's just firing. That's it. There's the first one. Strikes can bring this place alive, can it?
Sure can. 1-2 count to Yount. Just outside. Two down, nobody on. And Buck worried. 2-2. Yount eats it off the hands. He's quick. Yount's got to hurry. Greg does not get him.
How do you like that?
Well, he didn't hit it hard enough, and Nettles came on. He made as good a play as what he possibly could. He jams him, and Yount, who can run.
We talked about Yount the very first game of this series. He is one of the finest young players in baseball. He can do it all. Well,
he's there.
He is?
Yes, sir. He's standing right down there next to Bob Watson.
That's the answer. You're right. Here comes Coop.
Swings and misses.
Let me see what Coop did against this big old left-hander. I don't think much.
Bounce back to the mound. Well, he did too. He singled in the fourth inning off of game number two.
Close. Watson tried to act that one out.
I tell you, there was a good move by Rigetti. Was very close. He just did get back. 2. Randolph, backhand, goes to the bag, ahead of Yount, and the side is retired.
Just a few moments ago, you heard George Steinbrenner detail the events in the Yankee clubhouse as they lost last night and the team came into that clubhouse. Now, my talk with Rick Cerrone, his review of the same incident.
Rick, no ifs, ands, and buts. What happened when Steinbrenner got to the clubhouse after the game?
Well, Howard, some things were said out of his frustration, out of my frustration. It was just bad timing. I don't regret saying some of the things I did, but like I said today, it's over. We have to go out and win a ball game and forget about the past.
Each of you engaged in profanities, didn't you?
A little bit. George didn't use any vulgarities. I used most of them, but like I said, it was something done out of the heat of battle. You know, we had just lost a tough ball game. I had part in losing that ball game, and I took it to heart a little bit too much.
Now, did you or did you not get a letter from George Steinbrenner today, and what did it say if you did?
Well, I did receive a letter that I feel is from George Steinbrenner, and in the letter he had said that, you know, the vulgarities didn't bother him, nothing bothered him. What did bother him, me striking out with the tying run on base, didn't bother him. Mental errors that he will not tolerate, and I agree with him. I made a mistake. It will not be the last mistake I make, and if it is, I may be in the Hall of Fame. But, you know, in a way, he was saying, hey, it's over, it's behind us, let's go out and win a ball game.
What impact did the demonstration have on this club, in your opinion?
Well, you know, we'll have to see playing, but, you know, everybody seems to be a little bit closer now. They're all behind me. They all came over to me and said, you did what you had to do. It's over with, and now let's just play some baseball.
Pre-game comments of Yankee catcher Rick Cerrone. Today's cause célèbre in New York.
The word today, measured.
And the pitch to Jerry Mumphrey, top of the order. Larry Milburn second, and Dave Winfield will be the third man. Hits it high in the air to center field for Paul Molitor. One out. Bottom of the fifth inning, New York leading by a score of 4-2.
Wonder if Dwight Bernard, when the Mets dropped him, ever thought he'd be in a series like this.
He's had a good night.
Throws hard, Don, in the manner of all those young Met pitchers, you know?
That ball is lifted to left field. Dan Ogilvy's there. And Benji makes the catch. Two down.
Mets through the years, Howard, have had a lot of good arms. Go back to, I guess, the amazing Mets. The 1969.
Seaver. Ryan.
Look at Gary
Gentry.
Gary Gentry.
Guzman.
Yep. Matlack.
Matlack.
Winfield scratching around at the plate with two out. And David DeKnight is hitless in two trips.
Good sliders up there as you look at Reggie Jackson. McClure throwing in the bullpen again. I don't believe that Bob Rogers will take too many more chances with those left-handers following Winfield.
Just miss. One and one.
I don't think he wants to see another right-hander against Jackson either.
No, that's why he's got the left-hander throwing down there now. He's open at number one. He can get out of the inning here and then start off fresh with him. That is Bob McClure.
Second baseman Romero throws him out, so the inning is over. in the middle of the fifth. The Yankees 4, Brewers 2. Back to more baseball after this word from our local station. Ted Simmons, Gorman Thomas, and Ben Ogilvie. Out now against Dave Righetti. And the first time tonight they have seen the big left-hander.
This fastball has a lot of movement on it. He uses what you call, in the terminology of vernacular of pitching, a four-seam fastball. Not a real heavy ball.
Well, Simmons walked against him, tapped out to the first baseman, and singled against him. Game number two in Milwaukee. Toward the hole, Milburn. He gets Simmons because Ted just doesn't have that much speed to get down the line.
That's true, but still another solid play by Milburn. That youngster, not really that young, 31, who came from Seattle, continues to surprise. Steady as a rock.
Ball took a little tricky hop that he handled quite well.
It got over there. He got it in that little in-between hop. But then he's got a good arm. He's got a nose that Simmons does not run that well. He can set himself easily and make the proper throw.
Righetti, the first time he worked against Thomas, struck Bowman out twice and walked him. There's a strike. Hitting in the top of the sixth. Breaking pitch, strike two. After that 95-mile-an-hour fastball, that curve just floated up there. At least optically, it appeared that way.
I mentioned that earlier. Gorman, the only man to hit a home run against Righetti this year. Oh-ho!
Wanted that one.
With a fastball and just, I don't know, doesn't look too bad right there.
1-2. That's two out, and here's Ben Ogilvie.
I can tell you, this guy's sick to death of looking at Yankee southpaws.
Well, Ben has had a tough time, but he's got a base hit tonight. He got his first hit yesterday. He struck out seven times in the series.
He struck out twice against Righetti in Milwaukee on Thursday. Rolled up the middle. Ogilvie's got a base hit.
Not so tired anymore.
Third baseman, Sal Bando.
Sal Bando with two out. And Ogilvie at first. He just challenged Sal there. He threw him a high fastball.
Right.
There it is. Take a wipe.
You're exactly right.
2-1.
Well, you got to know that Sal just thinking fastball all the way.
3-1.
You got to know that Righetti is not as strong, not as sharp as he was in his starting effort the second game.
Pitched a whale of a ball game, six innings, striking out 10. That's not all that bad.
Inside corner, 3-2.
He'll sometimes cut that fastball coming out there, and if you're a right-hand hitter, it has a tendency, it'll run in on you. It's not as big as a slider, but a cut fastball will work in the same line.
Runner goes on 3-2. Bando walks. Now it's Charlie Moore.
The right fielder, Charlie Moore.
Two out, two on. Yankee
Yankees leading in the ball game here in the top of the sixth inning by a score of 4-2. All four runs coming in the bottom of the fourth inning. Reggie Jackson, a two-run homer, and Oscar Gamble a solo.
Looking to get to the eighth inning when a fresh Gossage could be called upon.
Two balls and no strikes.
That is the young lady who at the moment is dating Dave Righetti. Her name is Chris Kern. How that relates to Dave's next pitch, I'm not sure.
Jackson. Righetti gets away. So we've gone 5.5. And it's 4-2 New York. Bob McClure comes on now with his third appearance in the series. See that he had limited work during the regular season, but has been busy in the series. And Bob Rogers wanted to get this left-hander in because you have Reggie Jackson, Oscar Gamble, Greg Nettles, three left-handed hitters in a row coming up. Jackson last time up hit a two-run home run. Last time up, Gamble hit a solo home run. That was back in the fourth inning when the Yankees counted four times to take a 4-2 lead. Out of the way to make it 1-2. Barely got him. Gamble strikes out.
That was.
One out for Nettles. Position. It was hit off the end of the bat. After that, it's all academic. 4-2, New York. Here is Don Money walking up to hit for Ed Romero. Seasoned veteran. So Bob Rogers now, who without question and
particularly in perspective of what he faces from the other side of the field, has a limited bench.
Number seven, Don Money.
It'll be Money, then the top of the order, Molitor and Yount against Rigetti. Rigetti coming on in relief of Guidry in the fifth inning.
Well, you're zeroing in on Goose Gossage territory right now, and that's what Bob Lemon is hoping for. Talking Rigetti, just give me one good inning, young man, and after that, I'll try and take over from there. There's Lim.
Clyde King.
Money hits it in the air on the right side. Ball is drifting back toward the stands. Watson is over. He's got it. He's got it.
Quite a play.
Boy, there's a big play right there by Bob Watson.
Helps to be 6'4", doesn't it?
It does. And watch Mike Riley and give him credit. The first base umpire over there to see any kind of interference whatsoever. Now, he's on his own now. Fan knocks it out.
Nope, right in
there's
there.
No play, but Bob Watson reaches in with that glove, and the fans, you can tell they're true Yankee fans down there. They just got out of the way and said, go get it, big guy.
Interesting picture.
Molitor hits it in the air to center. Humphrey. Two down. Rigetti goes on at this pace.
We'll
be looking at Gossenstein at 8 and 9, and they're moving around in the Yankee pen. Goose is up.
Didn't you know?
Hello. Singles. Ball is pretty well hit to deep left center field. Way back. Way back. It bangs off the wall. Yount turns second. Heading for third. The throw. He's in there with a triple.
How do you punks like Robin Yount? Is he a ball player?
You darn right he's a ball player and a good one. You know, this is the thing that Milwaukee has done now the last couple of innings, which you really don't like to see if you're sitting on the Milwaukee side. They've got a little something going in the last two innings. As we take another look at it, there's a fastball. Robin jumps all over it. Any other ballpark, that is long gone, but he's testing Death Valley right here. He short hops that bullpen gate out there. Winfield gets on it in a hurry. But the last two innings, they've had something going with two outs.
Yep.
And that's what's tough.
Up to Coop to get Yount home. He's going to do it with a single to left field.
Oh, boy.
And it's 4-3. Yankee lead cut to one.
And Mr. Gossage working in a little hurry now out in the Yankee bullpen. Here comes Bob Lemon.
And how quickly they do it. Gosh, how I respect this Milwaukee team and admire them.
Wants to take a little time to settle Rigetti down. Here's a fastball. Cooper just goes the other way. Hits a line drive by Nettles. No chance whatsoever. That ball's hit too hard. Yount scores easily from third. You have a 4-3 ball game.
Goose is not ready.
No, he's not ready yet. So Lem is just taking a little time. And just to settle the youngster down, I'm sure. Don't worry about that. We still got a leg up on him.
It's Ted Simmons. He isn't easy.
He turned everything around for Milwaukee. Two-run home run. They had been trailing Tommy John in the third game.
Pops it up on the right side, and this one is out of play.
Shows you how important Watson's catch was on Molitor. Had he gotten on, we'd have a tie ball game.
The
Goose is ready. He's got his hands on his hips watching. Wow. After that last foul ball, they just went back and started throwing again. Two-two with two out. Cooper on first. A 4-3 ball for him, and he strikes out Ted Simmons on a high fastball. So the kid does what he has been asked to do. And now you've got two innings to go in a 1-1 ball game. Middle of the seventh, 4-3 New York.
One event that more than any other brings out the youth in all of us. Baseball fever. Catch it. It's worth it.
The preceding message was furnished by Major League Baseball.
Don Money stays in the ball game. He hit for Romero, goes into second base now. You have the fifth Milwaukee pitcher, Jim Slayton. And Slayton, like McClure, has been, and Bernard, been very effective.
You must say, Buck Rogers has really manipulated these pitches. Like a master.
Well, he was a catcher.
That's exactly right, and a good one.
The first baseman.
He's done a good job over here at Milwaukee, and him and the Brewers, all of them. Bud Selig, Harry Dalton, right on down. They're all to be commended, regardless of the outcome of tonight's game. I think it's fun to go to Milwaukee. It's a nice city, and the people are nice people.
Good restaurants.
Yep.
Good wind.
Good what?
Wind off the lake.
Yeah. Especially in December, January, February, and March.
There's Raleigh in splendid isolation, just awaiting the call.
Bob Watson, Rick Cerrone, Willie Randolph for New York in the bottom of the seventh inning. 1-1. There are your football games for this coming Saturday. Texas, Arkansas, UCLA, Washington State, Brigham Young, San Diego State, Central Michigan, Toledo. Texas may very well be number one in the nation this week after that walloping of Oklahoma, 34-14. Throw across the country. Call the Yankee infield.
It,
tonight, being a little bit soft, it was a thought the other night we came in when Tommy John was pitching to serve him well with his sinker ball. Tonight it served Robin Yount quite well because a couple of his hits were helped by the soft texture of the Yankee infield. But that triple, that triple was something.
Oh, did he hit that?
I'm told there may be another game added to that regional lineup that you just saw a moment ago. Jim Slayton, the fifth Milwaukee pitcher. Haas started, still the pitcher of record. Caldwell, Bernard, McClure, Slayton.
Uh-oh. It's gone. Home run.
Rick Cerrone. A single and a home run in tonight's ball game.
His boss in the best way he possibly could.
He got a fastball right down the middle, and as soon as he hit it, Slayton didn't even look at it. He just dropped his head and started kicking around and straightening out the mound a little bit. Boy, there's a big home run, and look at, they send him back out.
There it is. Right there. Nailed it.
You know, standing and cheering and grinning, George Steinbrenner.
Yeah, he is.
He livens them up. It seems uncanny. Every time he starts leasing his ball players, they somehow or other respond.
Randolph fouls it away. There's Jamie.
Well, getting the left-hander up because you've got the left-handers approaching in that Yankee lineup again.
Yeah, you two have been talking about the irony of scores and what's happened in games to game. Here we are, 5-3, final score of game one. And game three, wasn't it? Laced the left field and went the other way for the Yankees. And then Milwaukee 5-3, and now once again. Randolph, first hit of the night. And we'll go back to the top of the order now for Jerry Mumphrey. With one out, Larry Milburn. And they're picking on Jim Slayton. Mumphrey, of course, switch hitter, turns around. Sharply to Money, whips it back to first. And the inning is over. So the looping liner to Don Money, whipped back to first to double off the runner. And after seven, it's 5-3 Yankees. Here's the man. Two innings to go, and the goose has come on. And he will pitch first to Gorman Thomas. Power against power. But remember, Thomas has a bad hand. Scoring summary reflected there on the screen. Milwaukee's first. Milwaukee's second. And that's where we were when we went to the fourth. Bottom of the fourth, the Yankees turned it around. Jackson and Gamble home runs to make it 4-2. And Milwaukee came back in the seventh. Yount's triple and Cooper's single to get it back to a 4-3 circumstance. And then the Yankees with Cerrone hitting the home run to left to make it 5-3. So here is Rich Gussage. He's had a day's rest. And it looks like he's ready to go bear hunting.
You better believe it.
You know what? The first pitch is 96 miles an hour. Now that's intimidation.
I tell you, you hit against a guy like there's no need waiting on him. You know what you're going to get.
Heat in capital letters. That's only 97 miles an hour. Struck him out. That's nine times that Thomas has struck out in the series.
He does look awesome, though.
Well, he just flat throws this one right on by him. And it's up a little bit, and that is out of the strike zone. But that high, hard one, boy, that is tough for hitters to lay off of. Now it's Benji and Ogilvie.
He's going to get his swings.
You get three tries for a quarter, and he's going to get them all. Gossage has now faced 18 batters in this series. He has retired 15. Ball one. One and one. He has allowed three singles. Him up. Right side for Watson. Two down.
I'll tell you, though, when the old goose comes in, it's exciting. Immediately it becomes exciting. Well, look at the crowd. They reflect it. It's exactly why Mr. Forty showed them.
Sal Bando.
You know, as much of the talk that has gone on and the meeting they had yesterday after the game and everything considered, we've had five, I think, good ball games in this series. You're only there, it's only halfway. You got to still face Billy Martin and the Oakland A's before you can go to the series. Milwaukee's third baseman. Is that the plan?
I would guess he's a high-salaried ball player, much more than the average fan would think.
Message high away to Howell.
He can hit, as I suggested in the early going of this series. He has always plagued the Yankees.
Ball two.
And suddenly Goose is having trouble.
Well, the thing that's happening is just to keep putting the men on base, you start turning that lineup over a little bit. High on the right side, Bob Watson drifting back to the rail for a look at it. It's in the crowd. He was right on that pitch.
Yep.
This is a tough cookie. He can hit it out of here.
You better believe he can hit it out of here. He's a good fastball hitter. Jams him inside, now goes to 3-1.
This is what you call asking for trouble.
It's two out. Huh. He's walked him, and Don Money now will come on. And Bob Lemon going out to the mound. Now, there's a case where Bob's got to go out. Gossage throwing and completely falling out of rhythm. You could see him stumbling around on the mound, and I think what Lim's going to go out, yet Hall of Fame pitcher, he's saying, just take it easy. You have to throw it through Cerrone, just get it up there with something on it.
Running.
Edwards is the pinch runner at first base now.
Edwards.
For Roy Howell. Gossage came on, struck out Thomas. Got Ogilvy to pop up to the first baseman. Then he walks Al Bando. Now he has walked Roy Howell. And he is pitching to Don Money. And for the third inning in a row, they get something going with the two outs staring him in the face.
Yep. Money through the years has been a good and dangerous hitter.
Pitch is high, ball one.
He too has the power to hit it out.
Is not the swiftest of the swift. Little check swing, foul back. That tells
goose
us.
Or loose, I guess. Goose or loose.
That's it. For a moment flickers across the face of Sal Bando. Milwaukee can't do anything, though even they threaten severely. swing, money hat on the Gossage fastball. He really didn't have. It was sort of a flick of the wrist.
That's all.
Anything else.
You're right, Keith. It wasn't a real good swing.
Watch Winfield. Right to the wall. Come to me, baby. Larry Milburn hits it to right center. Molitor comes across, cuts it off, and holds him to a single. Marshall Edwards is playing right field.
That's three hits for Milburn. He's been amazing.
Jamie Easterly throwing again in the Milwaukee bullpen, a left-hander, because after Winfield, that's what you've got.
Single by Randolph, and now a single by Milburn. Tommy John up throwing in the bullpen for New York.
Just another game. That's what Ron Guidry said, as the managers do not listen.
Short center field. Molitor coming hard. One hands it, whips it back. And there's no play at first. That thing was a mile high. Otherwise, Molitor has no chance to get to it.
Boy, he had a long way to go, and here comes Bob Rogers, and I got to believe that, well, we look at it again. Out on the end of the bat, Molitor was extremely deep. Money, who was on the hit and run going over to cover the bag, did not get back. Molitor looking to see who's coming, but with good speed, makes the catch. Milburn almost started to go to second base. It appeared that he might not get it.
Slayton leaves, and Jamie Easterly will come on for Milwaukee. We've got a timeout. Comes the sixth Milwaukee pitcher of the night. With one out, and Milburn on first base in the New York eighth. Reggie Jackson comes to the plate. You have Jackson, Gamble, Nettles, all left-handed hitters. Out in the Milwaukee bullpen now. Vukovich is warming up. He pitched last night. Scheduled to be the pitcher in the second game of the series. The tonsillitis, laryngitis, is quite ill. Easterly's first pitch to Jackson misses for ball one. 3-2 to Jackson. Loop to center, base hit. And Milburn turns and goes on to third. Runners on the corner. Now we'll see about Gamble.
Moose Haas, and then consecutive singles against left-handed pitchers. He hung in there.
Now you will get Padilla.
Well, here's where Bob Rogers has to gamble a little bit. I don't know if Vukovich is ready. Now the hat comes off in the bullpen from Larry Haney. The Vuk says he's ready. So if you go to Vukovich, he has to pitch to one man. Bob Lemon now sitting in the driver's seat. Because if they bring in Vukovich to pitch to Pinella, Lemon can counter with Bobby Mercer if he wants to.
More reverie.
Well, here's the gamble by Rogers right here. And I think what he's doing is hoping he's gambling on the ground ball as you look at Milburn at third and over at first, Reggie Jackson.
It's a big, big run.
Only one out. And Milburn is fleet. Third. Pinella not too quick. Reggie somewhere in between. Shot to right. Solid base hit. Going into the corner. Milburn scores. Jackson around goes to third. Pinella stands at second. Double. 6-3 New York.
sensational hitter. You see him guide that ball, Don.
He's been trying to hit the right field ever since he's got back to Yankee Stadium. He just lays the bat on the ball. They got a fastball out over the plate. He was going that way all the time. Take another look at it. He just tries to hit the ball to right field. Some pain showing up on the faces of the Brewers now. They're down by three in the bottom of the eighth inning. The Yankees may not be finished yet. Jackson is over at third. Greg Nettles is up at the bat with Pinella at second base. The infield is in. You still have only one out. Seven-to-three New York lead. Brewers with only one chance remaining in the top of the ninth inning. Bob Watson has a single and three trips. The crowd, 47,505. Lukey on the year was 14-4 for the Brewers. Ball is hit well to left. Ogilvy has room, though, and makes the catch to retire the side. So, after eight innings of play at Yankee Stadium, 7-3 New York, back with more after this word from our local station.
You know, it takes a lot to upset an easy-going guy like me. But tonight, I have meatballs, and they're laying here like hardballs. And the fettuccine feels like it'll be here next season. It's enough to give a guy an upset stomach.
Upset stomach, Pepto-Bismol. It coats, soothes, relieves.
Hey, I think I'll try a swig of this.
Billy, will you use a spoon?
Oh, no!
The top of the order for the Milwaukee Brewers. Paul Molitor, Robin Yount, and Cecil Cooper against Rich Gossage. He's trying to get his third save in this playoff series. Dave Righetti will get the win to be his second. One ball and one strike on Molitor. Pitch is low and away. Milwaukee leaving nine men tonight. The Yankees only three. Curveball is popped in the air to right center field for Mumphrey. There he has it. And you've got one out in the top of the ninth inning. News close up. Hooray for Hollywood. Swing and a foul tip into the glove of Cerrone.
This has been, I think it's fair to say, an interesting series. Moments of drama.
Ball is hit in the air down the left field line. Shortstop Milburn has the best shot at it and makes the catch. Oh, Mrs. Gossage now.
And even in now apparent defeat, I want to congratulate the Milwaukee Brewers and Buck Rogers and a group of fine athletes who've held together. And the Yankees, Keith said it before the second game, somehow they have the right people in the right place at the right time. And somehow, in the twilight of his baseball career, Reggie Jackson can still draw upon some inner resource and produce.
Cecil Cooper takes strike one. Two out.
As can Lou Piniella. As did Oscar Gamble.
That's foul in the crowd. It is now a contest between these two men, Gossage and Cooper. One ball, two strikes. Two balls and two strikes. Throw a change, looks like. Just show him something different. Now here comes the heater. Oh, gave him a curve ball. He pops it up. Greg Nettle. Game is over. Defeated the Milwaukee Brewers by a score of 7-3. Dave Righetti gets the win. Goose Gossage, his third save. Righetti's second win. Moose Haas, the loss, his second loss. The Milwaukee Brewers down 2-0, leaving their home stadium, came to New York and made a contest of it, winning two in a row before finally succumbing tonight.
So the usual pandemonium on the field, a reminder of a day as you look at a disconsolate member of the Brewers, reminder of the day when Chris Chambliss hit that home run, Keith, you and I were here to defeat Kansas City in what was then a league championship series.
In the line, it appeared that somebody had to ignite something on the Yankee bench, and the home run did it.
Well, I don't want to take that credit, really, but, you know, we really played very well today, and the ball club rose to the occasion. We got great pitching performances from Guidry and, of course, Righetti, who kind of deservingly really did exceptionally well because he lost the ERA title by like two-thirds of an inning or something like that. And then, of course, when you got 2-3-run lead for Goose, it's pretty much over. But the ball club played exceptionally well, very well-rounded baseball, Don, and I'm just glad to be a part of it. Thank God for the home run. I wasn't hitting anything, so I was happy.
You got a high curve ball.
Yes. Well, I asked Simmons, you know, what it was, because I thought I'd hit a bad breaking ball, too. But he said I hit a fork or that split finger fastball I've been working with, and it just kind of tumbled, you know, and stayed there for me. And I've just been hitting mistakes, and I guess that was one.
Reg, did the meeting yesterday, did that get anything? Did that help any at all?
You know, it's I don't know if it helps, but it seems to be kind of coincidental that whenever George raises hell or, you know, we kind of respond. But yesterday was something I'd really never seen before, Don, and I was disappointed and you know, kind of hurt by the whole thing that we would be kind of jumped on right after a loss. But, you know, the man owns the ball club. He does what he wants to do, and, you know, I may not agree with it, but damn sure seems like it works.
And you got your former manager coming in.
Well, yeah, Billy's coming in. That's right. I didn't even think about it. But the A's are, you know, hell of a club, but I don't know right now. I just want to, I'm glad that we came back because it sure didn't look good for the home team.
Reg, congratulations. Good luck with Oakland.
Thanks, Don. Thanks a lot.
Okay, and now right now we got Rick Cerrone coming in. Rick, congratulations. I know that it has to make you feel happy in light of what happened yesterday, and you get a couple of base hits tonight, and really a very big key home run that gave you that two-run lead again.
It was a great feeling. I know when I was circling the bases, it was that much closer we were to winning this thing. We struggled the last couple days, but we showed a lot of class coming back today and winning. You know, we were down 2-0, but got a great bunch of guys here, and something like this just might spark us all the way.
Okay, right now let's go back up to Keith Jackson.
All right, Don, thank you very much. It seems kind of quiet. There is no champagne cork being popped down there. They will not celebrate. This is just the first round. After the next round, they might get on to something a little more serious. We'll be right back after this word from our local stations. And now we'll meet the Oakland A's. 7-3 in New York in game number 5. Travel arrangements made through and promotional fee paid by United Airlines. United flies more people to Hawaii than any other airline. That's what friendly skies are all about. Tonight's game, a presentation of ABC Sports, recognized around the world as the leader in sports television.